Well, it is such a pleasure to have you with us today. As I was sharing with you kind of before we started recording, relationships have always been a big topic of interest for me since I was a young child. I think that it was always interesting to me, this idea of two people coming together and spending their life together, or, you know, getting to know each other in this way. As a young kid, I would kind of consider, like, you know, when I would think of my partner, it was like this person that would like have my back, and we would kind of like go through life and like experience all the things together. And then I, you know, my parents split when I was younger, which I always knew that they would. It was just one of those things. They were not a big fan of each other. And going through that divorce was also very interesting to me, watching all of the different dynamics going on. And I've just always been this person who's really paid attention to relationships in my life, you know, whether it was like with my friends, the adults that I was around. And then when I started getting into relationships as well, it was something that was like, okay, this is interesting and different, and getting to know someone. And I feel like there's just so many things to navigate when it comes to relationships. And I think one of the things that I feel is so important is, you know, the truth of what relationships are, and being able to share, you know, that it's not this over romanticized thing. I think relationships are beautiful, and I definitely think that they're what make life worth living. But at the same time, I think there's so much, you know, as a young girl growing up and seeing Disney movies or all of these other movies, these, again, romanticized ideas of what it's to be in relationship, instead of really being able to see the many aspects of relationship and being honest about those, so that people walk into relationships with the tools. So I kind of want to start in a completely random place. It came to me this morning, and I was so excited to have you on the show, because like I shared, having a masculine voice in all of this, I think, is just so important. We need more of those. But I would love for you to kind of start off talking about trust and why trust is so important for women in relationships in particular. I think that it's not that it's not important for men as much, but I feel like it's such a vital piece of the vibrance for the feminine. But I would just love to get your kind of take on this.
Yeah. So the way that I like to see relationships is like a house. And the masculine and the feminine, and throughout this conversation, I may refer to men and to women, but disclaimer, sometimes there are men that are more feminine, women that are more masculine. So with that being said, the masculine of men, usually like the masculine refers to that part that provides the structure, the safety, the stability. The feminine will be the feeling of home, right? The in very essential ways, the masculine is consciousness, and the feminine is energy, or the masculine is structure, and the feminine is flow. And if we go from this place, and we think about relationships as something fundamental, not as a man dating a woman, having kids and so on, but as a fundamental dimension of life, which is that of like attraction and then distance. Like our atoms are vibrating, is where dancing is, where every relationship is an expression of the same dance. Now, what happens when we have too much energy with not enough conscience? What happens when we have too much emotion without enough structure? And what happens is chaos, like unbridled chaos, which is damaging to everybody. So why this is important in relationship to trust is that trust is one of the most foundational structures that a man can create in a relationship. And what that means is that you have very reliable foundations upon which everything else is built. Trust means that, like, for example, I work with indigenous communities in Colombia, and in a medicine ceremony, the shaman is somebody that is playing within the dance of magic and reality, a stable reality, and playing with the energies of nature. And they need people can allow themselves to go deep only because there's trust in the shaman. The more energy you're running through any space, the stronger the foundations have to be. So if we see our romantic relationships as a place where we want to run increased amounts of energy, we can call it love, we can call it passion, we can call it maybe a larger vision. Usually it's a mix of everything. We want to be best friends, we want to be great lovers, and we want to be a power couple. We want to change the world or impact it in a significant way, or at least our community. So what that means is there's more life happening between the two of us. The more life that happens between the two of us, the more the structure has to be solid. Otherwise, we will fry ourselves with it. So trust, in a very simple way, it acts as oil to the engine of the relationship. If you cannot trust, or if the words that I give is not what I mean, then it is impossible to have a relationship, because you don't know if what I say, I mean it. You don't know where you're standing with me. And for the feminine, if a feminine woman wants to allow herself to feel the depth of her heart or of her desire, she needs to stand, she needs to feel like, if she's going to turn into pure energy or pure water and be just flexible and fully self-expressed, then she needs to feel that there's a reliable container that can hold it. And that's what integrity, which goes hand in hand with trust, does. So unfortunately, our society today, and men in general, and I include myself there, like, we are raised in a way that we learn that you can get away with lies, or you can avoid speaking the truth, and you can avoid conflict if you misrepresent the truth or if you don't share it fully. So we don't think about this in the moment, but what it does is it creates, like, my experience when I used to date women and I was not trustworthy, I would complain that they're being so dramatic and so annoying, and like, why are you making such a big deal out of things? And it's like, well, like, of course, if you and I are, let's say we're in the same house and we want to have a great conversation together, which is a form of play, we can only do so because we trust the house. Trust is the foundation. It's not going to fall on us. But if we're having a conversation and there's bricks falling on the sides and things are shaking, it's going to be impossible for us to do anything, because to do anything else than feel anxious or feel this strong desire to reach towards safety. And I think one of the things I have witnessed, that most relationships operate in very shaky grounds, and they wonder why do we feel so anxious, why it's hard to be loving with each other. Well, of course, everything is falling apart. There's no question of building the experience of home if the foundations of the house are not reliable.
Yeah, I love that. I love that a lot. I mean, I was having so many different things popping up while you were talking. You know, first, I think so much of this word trust, people think it's this black and white thing. And I don't know if you're familiar with Brené Brown's definition of trust. Like, she breaks it down into seven different types of trust. It's really powerful, because I know in my own relationship, we've had conversations where it's been like, I don't trust you, but it's not like all of the areas I don't trust. You know what I'm saying? It's not like I think he's going to go out and cheat on me, or I think he's going to X, Y, Z. my trust is only like, you know, the trust I'm talking about is only about certain things within the relationship. And so I think that when people think about trust, like they just kind of take it as like that sort of surface level meaning, you know, of like, oh, you're going to cheat on me or something, instead of realizing there's so much more there when it comes to the word trust. Learning that for me was really powerful. It helped me to better understand why I was feeling the ways that I was feeling. But I've seen this so much in the women in my life in regards to this deep requirement of trust within a relationship and how difficult it is for them to get it. And then trying to make a relationship work without it. And I think that your metaphor of the house feels very aligned in regards to, I mean, it makes complete sense to me. I've experienced that in my own relationships, you know, I can't show up as my full self when I don't feel like I'm in a trusting and like, you know, when I'm in an environment where I'm really held. And that's mm-hmm. fully aligned with the trust that I have for whomever I'm opening up to. And I grew up with a mother who's like a superwoman. There's nothing my mom can't do, but she was never able to fully be in her feminine because both of the men that she married, she didn't trust that they would take care of her. She didn't trust that they, you know what I mean? Would do whatever it was that they needed to do. I mean, there's so many layers there, but, and so she was never able to, like, her dream was to be a housewife. And my mom like became a CEO. She like, she's amazing. Because she could, but it wasn't what she wanted. And so without that trust, it was like only like it never came to be what it ever could be.
Yeah.
I just feel like it's one of those topics that's not talked about enough in regards to women specifically. And when I say women, I definitely mean feminine, as you pointed out. Thank you. but that feminine really needing to have that stable foundation in order to grow and expand. So what is your, you know, like when working with couples or when working with women, I'm sure that some women come to you without their partners. Like, what is your advice to them? How do you, you know, help them to navigate that?
Mm-hmm. So there's the way that I work with some of my female clients is like there's something that is important to understand. Of course, trust is necessary. Trust allows for a woman to relax and for her to be more in her feminine. At the same time, trust is often a word that we use to blackmail each other or to try to force and put a cage around another life. I don't trust you. What do I mean when I say I don't trust you? I mean, you're not acting the way that I think you should have acted. What I'm saying is that my expectation, your actions do not match my expectations of you. Now, whose problem is that? We put it on you're untrustworthy, but in reality, I feel insecure. I don't feel safe. So on one hand, I vouch for the creation of the foundations of safety within a relationship, supporting each other, making it easier for each other, for each other's nervous systems to be relaxed and at ease, which is the feeling of safety. But on the other hand, I'm a bit ruthless in the sense that every time that you tell somebody, I don't trust you, you're speaking about yourself. Every time that you say somebody broke your trust, what you're trying to say is they're being themselves. Just you don't like who they are when they are themselves. And you wish they acted different. You wish they were different, which it's a very erroneous and painful way of navigating reality. Because if my relationship with you can only flourish if you act in the ways that I expect you will act, it's not if, it's when we're gonna come to a clash, because you're a changing life and you will do something that is outside of my assumptions of who you are. And I think that's beautiful. That means you're a life that keeps evolving. If I can put you into a box of what I can expect and not expect of you, and if you're a good girl or a good boy for men, and we try to fulfill that box because we want to be trustworthy, we often stifle life. We often cut out a part of ourselves. Now, of course, this is a sensitive topic because we pushed too far. Some people take it as I can do whatever I want and there's no accountability. I'm not responsible for anything. And it's your problem if you feel insecure. I am just being myself. That's maybe an extreme of things. With that said, I feel the deepest form of trust that I can have or that I can support someone in reaching is that where I understand that my partner is a part of creation. That creator, whatever I believe in, God, source, energy, the universe, evolution, whatever I believe in, a higher intelligence created my partner. And I think there's something wrong with that. I think that I know better than life. I think that my ideas of how life should be are more correct or better than what the creator designed for them. So in that part, I'm fighting against life. I'm fighting against reality. Ultimately, the only way of fully trusting somebody in the traditional way is, for example, I trust my wife completely. I trust her to be herself. And the way she is sometimes unpredictable. So I can trust that she will do whatever she feels like doing. And I trust that she will make the choices that feel most nourishing for her. Now, with my clients, back to your question, this may sound a little rough, but I work mostly with women that are in long-term relationships or married, but when I've worked with women who are single, I believe it was Mark Twain that said, like, never try to teach a pig how to sing. It will frustrate you and it will annoy the pig. And largely that's what most people are doing in relationships. And it's like, I don't trust you. And they come to their partners like you have to change something. And instead of realizing like, hey, maybe I am, you know, the reason I can't trust him is because I can't trust myself to make good choices when it comes to my partners. But that's harder for somebody to embrace. Easier to think he needs to mature, he needs to be more honest, he needs to be more transparent, he needs to communicate better, than to say, I am attracted to men that lie. I am emotionally avoidant. I am afraid of commitment, or there's a part of me that makes poor choices when it comes to men, right? So the first step is always in recognizing, recognizing that, is this something to work out relationally? You know, like you move into a house and you can paint the walls and maybe there's some drywall that has some mold, you can tear it down, fix it. Of course, no house is perfect, so there's always going to be some renovations happening, let's call it. But if you get into a house and the whole thing is falling apart, like, I don't want to say it's impossible, but it's very painful to sit there and maybe you're fixing something and something else is falling apart and you're bound to be very frustrated about the house. Well, you could be in one that you enjoy that does not demand that much overwhelmed constant friction just for it to look a certain way. So recognizing that, is this a relationship that we're sure, where the beauty of it is greater than the work that we have to do, then if so, then sure, there's steps for that. But sometimes the most difficult part for someone to recognize is, hey, like, I've made a choice that does not serve me. Then the question there is understanding why I made that choice so I don't make it again.
Yeah, you're talking about what I like to call radical responsibility. Yeah, I think that, I mean, we're certainly not taught to look at ourselves first. And I know I have caught myself before feeling like I can't trust my partner and immediately realizing like, yo, this is about me. This is about where I'm at right now. And of course, I think that our partners are always mirrors for us. I think, you know, everyone in our life is a mirror for us. But of course, we aren't raised to look at that mirror or ask the hard questions. You know, it's like the woman who's been married 5 times. And she's like, I don't know why I can't find a good husband. And it's like, so the common denominator here is you, girlfriend. You know, I think so much of, and I feel like that's honestly part of why I've always been so intrigued with relationships, is that it's always been readily apparent. It's not, while there is this importance of what you do when you come together, but there's also this, I don't want to say, well, I guess just deeper importance of who you are on your own and how you show up and how you're able to show up to any relationship. And what you're able to bring into it. So, yeah, I mean, I think that there's definitely relationships, and I've been in them before, where it's like the foundation is, it has so many cracks in it and so many walls and, or so many holes in the wall, that putting it back together or trying to make it work is going to require more work than is really, you know, the good and the bad just don't. The good doesn't outweigh the bad. You know, the, like you said, the beauty of the relationship isn't able to show through in the midst of all that work, because of course you're spending so much time. I'm really curious to hear, like, I mean, obviously conflict is a part of every relationship, and I wish that conflict was talked about so much more. I feel like as a planet, we are awakening, and I feel like there is a lot more discussion about it. But I'm curious to hear from you, like, in regards to your work, the things that you've done, like, what do you really believe is, like, at the root of conflict within relationships?
At the root of conflict. A rejection of life and inability of being present to parts of life that are painful. Ultimately, this is not parts of our partner, but parts of ourselves. And like a quick example of this, I wrote about this my newsletter recently, was, let's say, a woman comes and tells her husband, why didn't you take out the trash? Or just, you didn't take out the trash. What he hears, what most men hear, is, you're not good enough. You're failing. You're unlovable. There's something wrong with you. Like, why? Because things get filtered through the lens of shame, the lens of our own trauma, our own wounding. Every single argument, every single conflict that we have in relationships is about unprocessed parts of our past, and rarely, if ever at all, about the relationship or about our partner. Just our partner provides a very vibrant and alive and clear context where we can relief and process and hopefully integrate those wounds. But if you look at, like, every time that I have worked with couples that are edging divorce or separation, if you look at the way that they argue, like, you can see even their physical postures and the way they respond and everything, it's two children, it's two younger parts of them are coming to try and fight and force or yell in the hopes of getting needs met that were not met when they were young. Somebody feels ashamed and then they start attacking and maybe putting the other person down and ensuring that they do not feel disrespected. Even though what the partner may have said was not disrespectful to begin with. So at the root of all conflict, what it is unprocessed, undigested memory. You can call it trauma, it can be called karma, there's different kinds of imprints, but there's a wound that we carry that has not yet been resolved. And our partner will bring up context within which we will relive it. And the context can be, it can be so silly. I laugh very often when I see this in my own marriage. Like the other day, I was, when my wife is in her moon period, I take care of her. She doesn't do anything around the house. I cook, like, she's, that time is for her to dedicate to herself, to do, to play, to sing, to write, paint. So I remember one day I was making lunch for her and asked her what she wanted. She said, oh, I want some plantain. And then I went to cook it. And in Colombia, you cook plantain with oil. And I'm preparing it. And then she came and she said, oh, please don't use oil. Add some water instead. Because she wanted it like steamed. And she didn't want it oily because it's less healthy. That's all she said. Like, please add some water. I don't want it oily. And then my reaction was like, I'm cooking for you. You're so unappreciative. Don't tell me what to do. Like, get out of the kitchen. Like, I felt that I'm doing something nice and she's here to control me and tell me what to do. And she's being picky and annoying and micromanaging. And she's like, so many things. And I snapped. And of course, there was this like tension and chaos. And then she didn't want to eat. And then now I feel appreciated. And when I thought about it, like, why, what happened there? And first, righteousness. Oh, she's controlling. Of course, she's mothering me, telling me what to do. It's like, well, really, you know, past the righteousness when I softened a little bit, I realized actually that, like, she just asked me to put water in the pan. But I heard my mom's voice, and my mom's, or I projected my mom's voice, my mom's tone of voice. And my mother was controlling and violent and micromanaging. And I was not allowed to be my own kid. I was not allowed to be my own man growing up at home because she always had something to say and she was very critical. So what it was, a shame response and a fear of being controlled. And my partner just wanted a healthy plantain with a little bit more water. And she had to deal with a shame response. And in that moment, I am sure she's being controlling, annoying, and grateful. Because I cannot see that what's coming out to play is the little Nicolas that his mother yelled at and criticized and punished, and nothing was ever good enough. So that's the core of it. Just wounding, and wounding that rarely has to do with each other.
Yeah, I'm like just getting teary listening to you because I'm like, I know that reaction. I have reacted that way so many times when, like, I'm trying to do something for someone and then they come in and, you know, say like, well, I want this. And I'm like, but I'm doing this. Like, I'm doing this for you. Like, it's such a visceral example for me in particular, I think, because also my mother, very much the same, very controlling, very critical, wanted to keep me in a box, you know, nothing was ever good enough, all of those things. So thank you so much for sharing that. And I think that everyone can relate to that on one level or another. So I feel like what what you are really talking about is that conflict is really about ourselves. It's not even about the other person. Is that correct?
So, yes, I would say 90% of it. There's like, I like to separate conflict into the practical, the details, and the emotional.
Hmm.
We suffer the emotional part of it. In that moment, the conflict was, I am cooking something with too much oil and she wants it with water. If it had been a conversation just about the details, oh, you want more water? Okay. I put that aside and bring another pan and make it no big deal, right? But the way in which she asked for it was also coming with a lot of emotions. The emotions of, you know, for her, like growing up with a father that never cared for his wife, for his kids, a father that was only self-centered. So mm-hmm. when she's cooking the thing with oil, what she thinks is he doesn't care about me.
Mm-hmm.
He's just about the way he likes things, right? So her words come charged with, I need to get my needs met because I can't trust for the men, for the masculine, to look after me. So once we touch it, it lands, we have matching wounds. So we have the details and then we have the emotions. She puts her emotions into it. It comes, I receive it, I attach my own emotions, and then now we have an argument. The emotional part is ours, it's very internal, and only we can deal with it. Of course, our partner can make a space that it's safer and more supportive of us processing these things. Like, now I know that if I'm preparing something or she comes with like this kind of energy, I don't take it personal because I see like, oh, like she's going through that reaction. I can be more compassionate. So we can support each other in that. It's not out of obligation, but out of just love and supporting each other. But there's a detailed part of it, which is, you know, at the end of the day, there's something very practical and relational, which is I am making something that she's going to eat that has too much oil. And so that part needs to be sorted out relationally. Right, like my partner is cheating on me. All right, what comes up for me, not being good enough, anger, rage, shame, that's for me to deal with. What came up for her, avoidance, why she had to cheat, that's for her to deal with. Now, once we can sort out the emotions out of the equation, there's something relational that needs to happen. It's like, hey, either we separate or you stop cheating, or like the practicalities of it. So it's important that both are addressed, because, well, especially the emotional part, because that's what weighs heavy on us. But if we only do that work without finding an actual resolution and plan forward, we can just go in loops, or we can have the same argument 100 times. And sure, every time we dig a little bit deeper into our trauma, but the relationship doesn't improve practically.
Yeah. Yeah, I like hearing the other side of it as well. I love plantain so much. Oh my gosh. I'm like, put the oil on, baby. But I do understand. It's not always, you know. Yeah, I could eat plantains all the time. So let's dive in, because I mean, I know everybody has experienced conflict, and I definitely want to dive into how to work with conflict, you know, because there are, gosh, I don't know if you ever saw, it's a very popular photo of, like, it was at Burning Man years ago. And it's like the outlines of these two people, and they're sitting back to back, and it's like their inner children are actually like, no, like they're trying to talk to each other, but they're, you know, the adult part of them is like facing outwards, like, whatever, I'm not talking to you. And I think it's, I mean, I know that in my own life, my inner child is, man, she is sensitive. And I, you know, I've worked with her a lot, but there's still so much to be done there. But I'd love for you to kind of break down how you work with conflict, And I really appreciate how you broke it apart, the practical and the emotional, because there very much is those two separate parts when it comes to working with conflict. I mean, even in my own mind, that gives me a nice framework, you know, to think about when thinking about an argument or something of that nature. So I'll stop talking and and let you kind of lead us in that.
So how to work with conflict? Here's something that very few people pay attention to, but conflict is not what happens just when my partner does something that bothers me. Conflict in a profound way, and if we maybe dip our toes into a bit of spiritual concepts, conflict is the resistance and the friction I carry within myself. The ways in which I am not flowing in a harmonious way with the current of life, and therefore of love. And that's bound to show in my health, in my relationship health, my financial health. So where I'm going with this is, I would say a lot of conflict has to do with emotions that are too volatile. Most couples struggle because they can't. And it's not about controlling their emotions, but it's about having a healthy relationship with them, freeing them in a way that doesn't burn or destroy those that are around them. So in a very practical way, something that I ask the people that I work with in the beginning is, like, is your partner really annoying? Are they really difficult to be with? Or are you operating in a deficit of self-care and nervous system that is dysregulated, and you're eating like shit, you know, like until you have a clean system, you can't know for sure if it's you or if it's them or something that is happening in space. It's like, you know, if you have glasses that are dirty and you walk into a house, like, is the house dirty or is it your glasses? Like, until you clean them, you don't know for sure what needs attention. For a lot of people, what needs attention is not their relationship, not their partner, or what they're doing, but when it's attention is, so it's sort of like something as simple and basic as how you're eating. My relationship, if I eat poorly, if I don't sleep, I am more irritable. There's unnecessary conflict. We've grown to recognize this in ourselves, with my wife. And sometimes I'll be there and I can sense she's like annoyed. And before, she used to just snap or argue for no reason. And now maybe we're having a conversation and she'll say, like, I'm feeling really off today. I feel annoyed. I don't know what it is about. And if she explores it, like, well, yeah, you know, I just ate a couple of desserts. I didn't sleep last night. So we know there's nothing really to sort out between us. We could spend time, oh, why did you say that? Why did you treat me that way? You looked at me in a certain way. You left the toilet seat up, down. We could get into it, but it's useless because the root of her uneasiness is physiological inflammation at the core of it. So first thing is, cleanse your body, you eat well, you sleep well, you work out. This alone, for most people, like, they realize, well, my partner has become so much more pleasant. It's like, no, just life is more pleasant when you take care of yourself.
Oh yeah.
So that's like step number one. And I see it. I sleep well, I worked out, I did yoga in the morning, I'm eating healthy. My wife has come sometimes with something. And I look at her and like, oh, you're so sexy when you're angry. And then like, it goes out the window. But I am tense, I'm stressed, I just had a long flight, I didn't sleep. I come home and something's a little dusty. I'm like, wow, like, I was expecting more from you. Like, the home is messy, this is how you welcome me. You know, it's like we become so critical over little things. This actually happened one time, and the next day I woke up and I was refreshed. And she was like, "Oh, I'm sorry, love. I'll pay more attention next time." And next day I woke up and I looked around, and actually like 99% of the house was impeccable in Colombian. And I felt like an asshole. And I came to her and I said, "Love, I'm sorry. Like, there's no problem with the house. I was just like annoyed and tired and just feeling critical in general. I'm sorry. Like, yeah, I apologize for putting it on you." Which was hard, but you know, step number one, like, get it together and do what you can, because otherwise you may put on somebody else something that is not theirs to carry, or we may drown in a glass of water. So that's always number one. Like, are you overall like happy, healthy? Sure, you don't have to have perfect health, but if you're binging a lot of sugar and not working out and sleeping poorly,
like, oh yeah, it's bad news.
you're fighting an uphill battle. Yeah. You're making it very hard for yourself and for your partner. So in my relationship, in my marriage, me eating clean and working out is an act of devotion for my wife.
I love that.
My wife taking good care of herself is how she shows me that she loves me. Yesterday we had that. I was like tired and annoyed, and we had a call and we had to go through some documents because she got her visa to come to Canada. And then I'm just burdened. I'm like, okay, like, go to this, download this. And she's like, oh, do I need to send that? And in the letter it says, please send those pictures. I said, oh yes, did you read the letter? And I'm being like irritable. Did you not read the letter? It says exactly what you need to send. Oh, okay. And I caught myself being grumpy. And she was at the beach. She got a massage that day. She was like, she's in Russia right now. And I was grumpy. And then she's like, oh, my serious man, you look so good when you're serious. She's like, okay, love, you could smile. And I'm like, okay, love, like, let's get through it. And she'll make jokes like, oh, I wish I was there to, you know, and she got playful with it and cheese. And then there was just so long I could be grumpy. And then, like, she softened me eventually. She's like, oh, love, I love you so much. Thank you for doing this. Oh, you seem tired. I wish I could give you a massage. Like, she was extremely sweet. Her capacity to hold me and my grumpiness was great. It softened me, and she didn't suffer that. On a different day, that would have been a different conversation. She would have been like, why are you talking to me like that? Like, we're doing this together. I'm coming to see you. You know,
Brene Brown, I don't usually talk about her this much, but I mean, I'm definitely a huge fan. But she talks about how her and her husband, when they come home, like, their goal is to always be at 100% together. And so she'll be like, I've got 20 right now. I'm riding low. I got 20. And if he doesn't have that 80, you know, then their first thing is like to sit down and figure out how they can be kind to each other. You know, so maybe they'll order out food, or maybe they'll, like, you know, take some activities off their plate or whatever, just like what you're talking about, so that capacity is there. Because if, like, you were operating obviously at a lower percent, and fortunately she was able to fill that percent that was left. So then there wasn't an argument, you know, but of course that's not always possible. But I love that. And I think, I mean, for me, oh my gosh, when I get sleep, it's night and day. It's really, really huge for me, you know, taking care of myself. Absolutely. I don't have the patience. I don't have the capacity. I don't show up in the same way whatsoever when I'm not taking care of myself. So, and I love that you do that for each other. I think personally, that should be a part of every relationship, you know, because especially if you stay together forever, you're going to take care of each other as you get older. And it's not fair to have someone who's taking care of themselves and the other person's not, and then they have to, like, overcompensate. And, you know, like, that, those are just, obviously life happens, but I think that absolutely should be a pillar in a relationship, that you're meeting each other halfway in those things and doing it for each other.
Yeah. Do you have kids?
No.
Hmm.
I don't even have a goldfish.
Recently, I heard somebody say, you know, parents are, almost every parent is willing to die for their kids. But how many are willing to live for their kids, to eat healthier for their kids, to work out for their kids, to get their finances in order for their kids? Like, there are a few, and the whole thing is ridiculous. And I see an expression of this, like, for sure we are there will come a point in life for every single human being where our number one concern is going to be our health.
Yeah.
Now, to neglect that is irresponsible, but it is also like we are already placing a burden on our partner in the future.
Yeah.
Unnecessarily.
Yeah.
Right. If not for them, just for ourselves, just the shift that that makes. So when I work with couples, the first thing is, or with individuals in relationships, is like, okay, like the basics, like 101, just function at least at a normal capacity. Then we can look at the relationship, right? And then the next part is, how are you navigating conflict? Most couples are winging it.
Yeah.
They're constantly in pain. And I winged it for a big chunk of my relationship until I realized we were clashing in the same points. I was feeling frustration and not feeling seen, misunderstood, and resentment around the same key points in our communication. Being interrupted, her being defensive, or me being critical, or different things. And the next thing is like, okay, if we're gonna play with chaos and with the intensity of emotions, which is what conflict brings forward, a lot of energy in life that has not been digested in the past comes up to try and seek, you know, to complete the cycle and before the process. If we're gonna be playing with intense amounts of energy and heightened sensitivity, how's our structure? For most couples, it's just absent. So here's the next thing. Like, I teach people, like with my wife, we have we call it conflict navigation system. And it's a little template that I created. It's a Word document that we sat down one day and said, like, hey, we looked at the points where we both suffer in every time that we are having a difficult conversation, and we created an agreement of, this is the way, like this is the structure that we're going to use to navigate conflicts in our relation. And for us, it is sacred. And it is, if I'm having a conversation with her and she starts being sarcastic, I'll remind her, say, love, you and I have an agreement of how we will manage difficult conversations. Has that changed for you? I ask her. And this, or she'll ask me, hey, has this changed for you? And of course, in that moment, we want to be hurtful, we want to be spiteful, sarcastic. And there's two options. Either yes, it changed, I want to communicate with violence, and we have to renegotiate. I mean, I'm not down for that. Or most of the time, it's just like, hey, it's a reminder, like, there's something greater that we have committed to achieve: respect, kindness, empathy, listen. And sometimes I realize, like, I do not have the availability right now to mind the way in which I communicate. And I'll say, or I'll tell her, like, hey, I can see that right now it is very difficult for you to disagree with me. We will end this conversation right now. I am not disconnecting. I am here for whenever you're ready to have the conversation in the way that you and I agreed we will have it, right? And this is not to say that anger is not welcomed or difficult emotions are not welcomed. Anger is welcome. Yelling or attacking each other is not, right? So we're both invited to feel everything that is present, just not vomited on each other.
Yeah.
So we have a structure, and I realized First, I rejected that idea for a long time because I thought it's love. It should flow. You settle for love for each other. Things should work out. And then I realized like nothing in life works like that. You grab a guitar. You've never learned how to play it. Play it at random. It's not going to sound beautiful. You need some structure. Once you have structure, you can loosen it up a little bit and be more playful. And that's what, and also if it's a structure that the two of us share, it's not a restrictive one, but it's meant to create more freedom and more safety.
Yeah.
So back to the metaphor that you gave of the Burning Man picture, the sculpture, yeah, it was like a installation of these two people that were arguing, their inner child's touching hands. For example, one of the, a very practical thing that we do in my marriage, and this is from a very good friend that works only with men. He came up with something called the timeout. Well, it's called the hug out, actually. And what he discovered was when we are in a, what we suffer the most in the middle of a conflict is that in the moment we feel that we have been casted out of the other's heart. Mm. The moment we feel like we're each other's enemy, we no longer feel like we're together and we feel adversaries. Like the other person has withdrawn their love. And very often we do that. You did something I don't like, I take away my love, and then now there's judgment, there's blame, there's anger. Very few people know how to have a difficult conversation without closing their heart. It's very difficult. Like, I love you, and this is painful. Very few people have that capacity to keep their heart open as they navigate something difficult. And what we suffer is rarely the details, but the feeling that closure in the heart of somebody that we love and we want to be loved by. So what he came up with was this, that in the middle of the day, or especially of an argument, let's say if I notice that my partner is closing down, that her desire to be right or prove me wrong or desire to express her pain is greater than the want to stay connected, I can say hug out. What hug out means is that my relationship, this is also sacred, I can be working. Hug out means if a partner calls for a hug out, you both have to drop whatever you're doing. And you have to go and give each other a solid hug for at least 2 or 3 minutes. And this is very hard when you're angry at each other. Because
yeah.
The moment you think, oh, she's annoying, she's dramatic, or I am the asshole. And sometimes she's like, we are enemies in that moment, but we have forgotten that actually we love each other. And I'll call a hug out. And I can see it's awkward at the beginning because you don't want to be close, but you stay there for a couple of minutes and you soften and you remember that, wow, actually, like we're in this together and we love each other. And we don't have to close our hearts as we disagree. We can navigate pain without creating further distance, right? So there's been so many arguments that have been solved by the hug, but after the hug, we look at each other and we kind of, we get it. Or after the hug out, I look at her and I say, I'm sorry, love. You're right, I shouldn't have said that. I'm sorry that I made you feel that way. Once we feel connected, it's so much easier to want to see the other, to want to be there for them. But if we're fighting, then I want to defend myself. I want to be righteous. I want you to apologize. So, for example, that's just one of different structures that can be implemented during conflict that are very practical, but they provide more of a reliable structure to something that is otherwise pure chaos.
Well, it feels like a good tool, to kind of throw in the mix. I mean, my partner, his love language is physical touch, and I think he would really enjoy that. My attachment style is run. So I would be like, like I usually want space when I get upset because I'm very emotional. and I've got so many things happening in my body at one time that I really like to try and calm myself before I speak, before I communicate, because otherwise it could just be an explosion of a lot of things that I don't mean and things that I'm not really, you know, just like more of like, I need space. Cause again, I feel so much. And so, but I think that would be an interesting thing to employ in the midst of it in regards. I feel like that. Yeah. I think my partner is going to like that. We'll see how it goes. So kind of winding down here, I know that I can imagine there's a lot of different things in regards to working through conflict. You know, you're going to be sharing with us here momentarily about a course that you are creating for this. I do have like one other question for you that I love to ask, but is there anything that you would like to round out here in regards to like navigating conflict before we kind of switch topics?
Yeah, I would say a lot of people think that the relationship is bad because there's conflict. And actually, conflict means that both partners still want to be in the relationship.
Yeah.
Like, I only push back to you because I still have the hopes that things can be different, or that you can see me, or there can be more compassion, more love, more connection.
Yeah.
Absence of conflict is actually a sign that somebody has checked out and they're going to cheat. They're cheating, or they're already signing their documents with their lawyer. So conflict means that your partner still wants to be in a relationship with you, and they want for it to work, and they're still maybe in a clumsy way trying to make it work. So I'd say like it's something to welcome. And beyond that, also, there's so many wounds that will find expression in relationship. We may put them on our partner, we may forget that they're ours. At the end of the day, it's a great opportunity to learn to disagree with somebody that we love without closing down our heart. This is a spiritual practice. To learn to give that which we want to receive the most in relationships. This alone will transform a person's relationship radically. When I want to feel heard and seen and understood the most, that is the moment when it is the hardest for me to listen, to understand, to want to see. When to give the other that which we wish to receive, especially when we think they don't deserve it. That is the, I think, one of the foundational spiritual practices of relationship and conflict. Can my love be an expression of who I am and not a condition based on how my partner is behaving and what they have earned or not earned? Most people are afraid of going there. What? Loving unconditionally? What if they do this, and that? It's like, people are afraid that they're afraid their partner will take advantage of them being unconditionally loving. And I think everybody suffers. Of course, not easy, but I feel that for a relationship to become beautiful, not just okay or fine, but to be beautiful, both partners need to start seeing it as an opportunity to share the love that is in their heart. No matter what, if both partners do that, then, you know, how I treat you does not depend on you meeting my expectations of who you should be. How I treat you is an expression of the love that there is in my heart, and that's it. So I will say, yeah, that conflict is not a detour. It is the path towards better relationships. It's not something that happens by accident or when something is going wrong. what happens when things are going well means you're seeing parts of yourself that before were hidden from your awareness. You're understanding your partner in a deeper way. You're bringing your fragile hearts to be supported and cared for by each other. So it is a gift. If we know how to navigate it, it is the greatest gift. Yeah,
I think that, I mean, I know my partner when we first got together, because he had never been in a long, like in a, you know, relationship before. And it was great when we would have conflict because he'd be like, that was awesome. I learned something. That was so cool. And him and I were talking about that just the other day. I was like, we need to bring that attitude back. You know, that needs to, because of course, over all the years that we've been together, like that's been a while ago. And I think that changing our perspective on conflict is such an important part of the puzzle. Because when we change it from, it is an opportunity to get to know each other in a new way, to experience something new, potentially to learn how to open our hearts more, to be vulnerable, which I think is, at least for me and my relationship, probably the number one thing that always brings us back together is that vulnerability in the midst of wanting to close down. So like you're talking about keeping your heart open. But our perspective on conflict, you know, we're so averse to this in these times. And in this sort of swipe right society, people are like, oh, we're arguing, it's bad news. So thank you for sharing that, because that is such an important part of the puzzle for people. Okay. Honestly, I feel like my last question is going to be like out of left field. So we're going to wait on it. So Nico, I would love for you to share more about the work that you do, how people can work with you. Also about this very interesting course that you have coming up, that folks can learn more about. And can take. I assume this is online, going to be an online course.
Yes, it's an online course. So in essence, I work with people in relationships. It need not be the couple. It can be just one of them. It takes two people to argue, but only one person to transform a relationship.
You think so?
Yes, you can be like, you can be the one, you know, if It's impossible for a relationship to remain the same if one partner is like showing up with devotion, with love. And what I mean, it's impossible to stay the same. It means like, very quickly, in most cases, your partner like rises up and meets the other person. But in a few cases, it just becomes evident that your person will never meet you. And then the choice to leave also becomes like easy to make, which is people struggle because it's not too bad, it's not too good either, it's not great, it's not horrible, like do I stay, do I go, right? And they're waiting for their partners to improve so that they can feel better in the relationship. So all it takes is one person. They can be the one that transform that relationship into glory or distance. Both are useful, both are beautiful. So, yeah, we're with people in committed relationships that have found themselves feeling perhaps neglected, abandoned, not seen, often misunderstood by their partner. Perhaps, you know, well, not perhaps, like also facing the complex challenges of being an adult, sometimes having a family, running a business, paying taxes, just all the balls that we have to juggle. And on top of that, our partner has to juggle. And then on top of that, we have a relationship that sometimes goes at the last, the priority list. So couples where communication is not great, resentment has been building up, perhaps there's a question of I should be alone or separation or divorce, or at least grief around not feeling desired, not feeling there's aliveness. And those are the people that I work with that don't want to settle for mediocre love, that feel that more, that they're capable of so much more. Maybe they just don't know how, but they feel more is like, I'm not gonna age next to this person with this like frustration building little by little. I'm not gonna die a roommate with my wife or with my husband, right? The course coming up in August is gonna be focused around two things. First one is repair, which is like, especially if you're in a like sticky point in a gridlock where you feel that you can't get through to your partner, they can't get through to you, you don't feel seen, you don't feel understood, resentment has piled up, you don't know how to bring it forth without turning into the nagging, complaining, girlfriend, wife, husband. Basically, just a lot of stuff is in the space and you probably feel more resentment or distance and apathy than love. Then the first part of the course is going to be in that, like a structure, a guided way in which people are taught how do you clear up the space? Even if your partner doesn't seem interested in doing the work, you know, doesn't, all it takes is one person. You can be the one that through a conversation, you kind of unclog the pipes of years and years of other stuff that has gone in there. So the number one is that, is to clear the space, clear the air, make sure that honesty, vulnerability, and trust are present once again. And then the second part of that, and to me this is my favorite, is depth, which is like, okay, we don't hate each other anymore. We listen to each other. We're willing to sit and have a conversation and actually understand and hear each other. Now what? Well, now there's a space for depth, for deeper intimacy, for more passion. And again, this is there's also ways that are like, I'm sharing basically what has worked in my marriage and with people that I have worked with for close to a decade now around developing deeper connections. In simple ways, you know, sometimes people think like, oh, now I have to go on one date every day and I'm running my business. No, it doesn't take that long. It takes 1 or 2 hours a week. And even from home, there's, you know, I got people through a process, specific, I call it depth night, instead of date night, something they can do at home that's going to be better than any expensive vacation they've had in the last few years. Like my approach is highly practical, grounded in spiritual concepts and also like modern therapy and research. But the idea is that for people that are struggling, it's getting ugly, you clear the air and you reconnect, you reignite your relationship. And so you can feel like excited, inspired, proud of your partner. And this desired and desire, you know, I think we all lose that over time because we think that's the way things have to be. I just, you know, of course, love goes down, attraction goes down, you just become roommates and you co-parent, or that's it. That's how we assume it works. And that only happens because we allow for things to get in between us. But the depth of intimacy and passion can be worked on, can be nourished. So yeah, it's a course that's going to be focused on practical ways to do that.
I love that. Yeah, I mean, I've always looked at, you know, at these relationships who follow like this sort of typical pattern. And then of course, they end up roommates, or of course, they end up going different directions. And you know, I mean, there's no judgment involved from my end. And yet at the same time, I just think like, it's up to you, you know, it's up to both of you to get there. Like you've got to put in the time, you've got to make it a priority. You've got to, you know what I mean? Or not, It's completely, but it's up to you either way. So you either choose to become roommates or you choose, you know, to build a love. And either way, it's a choice. You know, it doesn't, our ideas, we don't have to fall prey to what everyone else is doing or these ideas that we're going to lose passion or we're going to become roommates or anything like that. It is completely up to us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. People forget, they don't, sometimes they're like, oh, it's awkward, takes too much time. It's like, have you ever seen somebody get a divorce?
you either put it in or you don't. I mean, that's relationship. It's of mm-hmm. course it takes time, but that's, you know, then you get to reap the rewards as well. You know. go ahead. I interrupted you.
Yes, I was going to say that sometimes people, like, they see their relationship like another responsibility. And it's like you spend most of your day with this person. You probably, it is the person with whom you're going to spend the most time in your life. The ones that are going to take care of you when you're old, or you'll be taking care of them. And you really just want to wing it or leave it to luck how the relationship unfolds. Sure, but then the results speak for themselves. And I think that's also why we have huge divorce rates and apathy, even in married couples, or couples that have been together for a long time. And it's ugly. I have many family members that, like, you can see they're together because they have kids, but there's no love, there's no desire. They don't even hug each other or kiss each other. Doesn't have to be that way.
Yeah, no, not at all. I personally would prefer to be single. any day of the week versus that. Mm-hmm. So you also do retreats. Do you want to share about that real quick too?
Yes. Yeah. This is exciting this year. So I work with an indigenous community in Colombia, ayahuasca community. And a lot of what I've learned about love and relationships has been from plant medicine. We actually I proposed to my wife on a plant medicine temple in Colombia. And we have this coming November 20 to 29, an ayahuasca retreat. It's 9 days. And it's focused on relationships. It's not only for couples, although there's couples, singles, and people who are in a relationship also coming with other partner. But it's going to be focused on healing the masculine and the feminine within us, so that outside of us, it can also find healthier expression. So, you know how we spoke about all the emotions that create most of our conflict?
Yeah.
Trauma. So we're going to go deep into the father wound, mother wound, kind of clear that up, so that when we come back into our relationships, we can, well, more harmony is already present, just because now it's a reflection of how we're operating from the inside. So that is a deep dive. It's a bit of a rough journey, because the medicine in Colombia is not called ayahuasca, it's called yahe, which is stronger than ayahuasca. It's prepared in a way. So it can be a rough journey, but one of profound clarity and healing. So that's happening. I usually do this once a year, and we're down to our last two spots. So also that's available if someone is interested.
Nice. Yeah, wonderful. Yeah, I've heard, I mean, oh gosh, I feel like a whole new conversation. I think having you back to talk about the masculine and the feminine would be really cool too, you know, to kind of dive into that. I've just been watching such incredible change, I think, happening in the collective, and it's slow. It's going to definitely take a lot of time, but I think talking about those subjects more and getting them out there so people you know, so much can happen just from hearing a conversation about it. You walk away seeing things a little differently. So wonderful. Well, thank you so much, Nico, for sharing your time and sharing your wisdom and just being here today. I really appreciate it. I appreciate so much the work that you're doing. And again, another male masculine voice out there talking about relationships, because we need this. You know, we didn't grow up seeing the majority of us didn't grow up seeing healthy examples of relationships. And so having more voices out there who are leading and guiding in this way is just so helpful. You know, when our relationships are good, then our kids are more aligned, and then like, it's just a trickle effect. So thank you so much for being here today.
Yes, thank you for having me. It was fun.
All right, folks, I hope you were inspired by today's discussion. If you enjoyed it, please share it with someone else who can benefit from it. Leave us a review on iTunes or Spotify. Sign up for my email list for podcast updates and other helpful resources. Sending you so much love. And don't forget, when we invest in ourselves, the world benefits. Until next time.